Hello and welcome to another Sprog Talk. I'm Malcolm Kelly, and with us today, I'm honored to have Ted Barris, a 19-time best-selling author of nonfiction history here in Canada. Welcome, Ted.
A pleasure, Malcolm. Nice to be with you.
And thank you. Ted, one of the main characters in Sprog is Claiborne Barry Taylor, who comes north from Abilene, Texas, in the months before Pearl Harbor to join the British Commonwealth Air Training Plan. He determines that he wants to get off to Europe and fight Hitler's Germany long before America is into the war. This was, Ted, I take it, not something that was unusual for Americans at the time.
That's exactly true. The fact of the matter that Americans, as much as anyone in North America and the world, had fallen in love with flying in the 20s and 30s. I mean, you think of Charles Lindbergh and Amelia Earhart and all these great aviators who really made young men and women fall in love with flying. When the American tradition of flying in the Great War had passed, there was a real flurry of activity after the Great War of young men seeking passage into the ranks of the U.S. Army Air Force, which emerged between the wars, but also because of that passion to fly. So it was sort of like having the thrill of flying and the recognition that with it came some tremendous power and indeed an elite form of flying. So aviation in the United States was romantic. It was attractive. It called out to young men and women. And when the war was looming in Europe in the 1930s, and the Nazis were obviously moving aggressively across Europe and occupying everywhere, it was most Americans sensed that unless they were completely isolationist and believed that there was probably going to be a time when America was going to be in the war, and why not step up and get involved? And because there was a long delay, many Americans came across the border, much as Clay did, almost illegally, almost hiding the fact. In fact, there was a committee in the United States called the Clayton Knight Committee, which sought out already qualified, capable pilots and navigators and smuggled them into Canada because the United States had a neutrality act. The American public could not be seen to be aiding and abetting a combatant, which Canada was. So that's what Clay was part of.
And when he arrived, when the Americans arrived, they joined what turned out to be an extraordinary effort that was later in the war referred to by Franklin Delano Roosevelt, the president of the United States, as the aerodrome of democracy. How large was the British Commonwealth Air Training Plan?
The BCATP was the largest expenditure Canada made during the Second World War. We created a lot of ships. We built a lot of armies. We had infrastructure right across the country in many ways. But the largest expenditure to train air crew, pilots, navigators, wireless radio operators, later on bomb aimers, flight crew of every shape on the ground and elsewhere, from instrument technicians to riggers and fitters. Everybody who was part of military aviation in the Commonwealth had the likely chance that they would come to Canada to learn how to do these trades. So $1.75 billion was spent by the Canadian government to train these young men. They came from the United States, across the Commonwealth, United Kingdom, Australia, New Zealand, Rhodesia, South Africa, India, Pakistan. They came from Belgium, refugees from Norway, cadets, Czechoslovakia, Poland, the Free French, Argentina. The young men came, flocked here to be part of this. In the course of the 5.5 years that the BCATP was operating, 104,000 Canadians were employed in its function day to day. There were, on any given day, 10 to 12,000 training aircraft in the air, training these aircrew and everything from fighter aircraft to bomber aircraft. And overall, in those 5.5 years, we trained 250,000 men. It was massive.
And they had to go through, Manning Depot, which was basic training. They went through initial training, ITS, where you were actually divided into what role you were going to do, pilot or navigator or radio or gunner. And then you went through as pilots, you went through EFTS, which was elementary, and then you went through advanced service flying training. But It was not as simple as that, Ted, was it? It was quite dangerous. It was not something that every day you were safe.
That's true. And as you advanced, the aircraft got more complicated. They got faster, more powerful, less forgiving. If you went from a Fleet Finch, which was a biplane, that's the plane you probably soloed on in about 8 hours. By the time you got to service flying training, you were doing anywhere from 14 to 16 weeks of every conceivable form of aerobatics and training in landing and taking off. You flew at night, you flew blind, you had to go through storms, you had to have engines cut off and recover, do forced landings. It was very dangerous. And in fact, when I was doing research for a book on the subject called Behind the Glory, I literally went from one end of the country looking into the graveyards and found more than 1,000 graves of instructors and students who died while training and being trained in the BCATP. It was very difficult. And it was also a high standard. If you couldn't cut it, if you couldn't solo in 8 hours, if you got sick in the air because you were doing inverted flying or, you know, loops and mock dogfighting, they washed you out because you were not good enough for the standard needed to fly a Spitfire or a Hurricane. If you couldn't fly at night, if you didn't know how to do that, you couldn't make bomber command. All these things were at such a high standard that they washed you out and said, sorry, no thanks. We're not interested in you if you can't meet this standard.
And also from a human standpoint, with 55,000 dead in Bomber Command, with 9,000, well over 9,000 of those dead being Canadian, but 55,000 dead in Bomber Command, an awful lot of those young men who left Canada to go to the war never went back to any of those countries that you mentioned that they had came from.
No, and there's another element that I discovered in my work on this subject. The kind of invisible commodity here, the hand at work in getting these young men to realize the dangers and overcome them, what they used to refer to as the quick and the dead, letting a young student recover an aircraft that was in an inverted spin before the instructor did it himself, allowing the young man to do that was an extraordinary trust, gift if you could get the young man to respond. But if you couldn't, and you couldn't do any of that in combat, it was a surefire way of quick death, and you would not make it back. The figures of losses are extremely high. I think the per capita numbers of losses in the Royal Canadian Air Force during in Bomber Command are the highest per capita of all the services because it was so dangerous. And as you pointed out in your novel, it didn't matter. Somehow, every one of these young men and women, because there were women involved in these services, not in front line combat, but certainly in support services, everyone believed she or he was invincible. He or she would get through. And those who did recognized that there were a lot who didn't.
And it's my final question, Ted. How important in terms of the overall war in Europe in the air do you believe that the BCATP was, especially in terms of if, for an example, there had not been a BCATP in these countries, especially Britain, had to train their pilots themselves? What sort of an effect do you think that would have had on the war?
Would have been impossible in Britain to do it because they were under fire constantly right from the beginning of the war. You can't train young men how to fly with combat going around you, which was why they put it in Canada across the other side of the ocean. So the reality was that divorced from the combat, this could go on. It could function as a training ground for to create a pipeline, if you like, of a continuous flow of qualified, capable, trained to high standard air crew to replenish those ranks that were depleted when it happened in Bomber Command or Fighter Command or Transport Command or Coastal Command. All those jobs could be replaced by the young men who were flowing. At one point, when the Battle of Britain is going on and Churchill is feeling his neck because they're short of pilots, somebody suggests that they stop the BCATP in 1940 and send all of the instructors over to join the Battle of Britain. Churchill says no. We will manage. It's important that this flow of qualified aircrew continue, and ultimately, when there's enough of them trained, we'll overcome the enemy, which is so true. And he referred to the British Commonwealth Air Training Plan as the decisive force in winning the war. So from the mouth of Churchill to the reality of history.
Ted, thank you so much for joining us today.
A pleasure. Thank you.
Don't let this parting upset you. I'll not forget you. Sweet.